kids. I'm Bob the Tomato.
Or perhaps you know me better as a somewhat uptight British asparagus.
Or maybe you'll know me best as a cantankerous decorative gourd.
Or a very old grape who doesn't know why he's in a vegetable show.
Or is it tiny French pea? Hello?
Or maybe you just know me best as the voice that says, and now it's time for City Songs with Larry. The part of the show where Larry comes out and sings a city song. Okay, thank you, and good night. I was here, I don't know if any of you were here when I was last here, it was like 6 years ago or something, so if you're a student and you were here then, you're really doing poorly. But thanks for still being here. And I think I mentioned at that time, we were at Moody Church, then my great-grandfather was one of the first radio preachers in America. He went on the air in 1923 in Omaha, Nebraska, and preached every Sunday morning, Omaha! Preached every Sunday morning until 1964 when he died, at which point his radio show was the oldest, longest-running radio show in America. He also spoke several times at Moody Founders Week in the 1930s and 1940s, I think through the 1950s. And then my grandparents, he started my great-grandfather started a Bible conference in Northwest Iowa, and my grandparents would come to Moody Founders Week every year and sit in the front row so they could review the speakers to see who they wanted to invite to their Bible conference in Iowa. So I actually have a long history. My grandmother actually went to Moody, learned to play the organ at Moody Church on the old organ. So I have a long, and I dated a Moody girl, but I married a Wheaton girl, but that's not a judgment, it's just how it worked out. Actually, the Moody girl dumped me, okay, so she went on some choir tour or something and then called me when she got back and said, I met someone on the bus. It's not nice. Don't do that, girls. Now they would just text. So I guess the call was better. Okay, I spent a lot of time speaking. Well, doing the VeggieTales thing was very interesting. I'm doing a lot of speaking now, but when I started, I was a really shy kid. I had no idea what I was doing. And the VeggieTales thing, you know, you get into areas where you have no idea what you're doing. I was 23 when I started it. So things come up, you know, they started selling, they were in Christian bookstores, and kids were all excited about them, and at that time, the most popular videos in Christian bookstores, you had Adventures in Odyssey, and you had Salty the Singing Songbook. Remember Salty the Singing Song? Yeah, I don't know whose idea that was, but... And Salty the Singing Songbook would send a costume out to bookstores, and someone would dress up as Salty and wobble around, and kids would say, woo, you know, and have big events. And so bookstores started saying, hey, we want Bob and Larry to come to the bookstore. And we were like, oh, they're animated characters. But, they said, no, like suits, send out suits. And I'm okay, well, so we got to come up with Bob and Larry suits. So the first generation of Bob and Larry suits were not successful. I want to explain why. First of all, if you've seen more recent ones, they're inflatable. They actually have battery packs and little fans, and so they're soft, and they're kind of squishy, and they also pack into a relatively small box that you can ship through, you know, the mail. It's affordable. The original ones were rigid, and like Larry was like 7 feet tall, and he was rigid, and we also had the issue of, so do they have arms or legs? You know, and we have to ask all these questions, because the characters don't have arms and legs, and we said, well, he has to have legs, right, or he can't get around. Okay, so he has legs. What about arms? He said, no, Bob and Larry don't have arms. So the suits had no armholes. This created several issues. The first issue, well, also they were rigid, so they actually had to be trucked around, because Larry was almost 7 feet tall. You couldn't just drop him in the mail. But then they had no armholes, so if you were inside Larry in a bookstore and you lost your balance, you just went down. You were cucumber down, rolling around like a turtle on his back. But some, that was bad enough. What made it worse was when kids would want to, like, I want to hug Bob and Larry. And they're like, I want to hug Bob and Larry. You know, and Bob and Larry just like, you know, that was as warm as they could be. And it even got worse when Bob and Larry were at a mall somewhere. They were at a mall Christian bookstore, and there was a line of kids who wanted to meet Bob and Larry, and they're standing there, you know, just bobbling. And a kid comes up, look, like 3-year-old kid, and he brought a hairbrush to give to Larry the Cucumber. Precious. So he brought a hairbrush to give to Larry the Cucumber, and he runs up, he's very excited, he runs up, and he says, here, Larry, I found your hairbrush. Oh, it's so cute. Well, Larry doesn't have any armholes. So Larry bends over to the kid, says, hold the hairbrush down by my leg. Kid goes, and a human hand sticks out of the leg hole, grabs the hairbrush, and pulls it back inside. And the kid runs back to his mom and says, Mom, Larry just grabbed my hairbrush with his butt. That's not even biblical. So it was time for Bob and Larry suits generation 2 at that point. And they got armholes, and everything was better from then on. So I've been speaking a lot. Your theme this year is running the race with endurance. And that's an awesome theme. The first part of that is relatively easy. We all know how to run. You know, you just take off running. I mean, we, you know, see a bear. Hey, I'm running the race. That's easy. It comes fairly natural to us. The second part is the tricky part, the endurance part, the not collapsing, the not killing yourself, the not ending up in the hospital. And that's what I want to talk about today, because I have some personal experience with that. I speak a lot, and I've been speaking a lot to children's ministry workers at children's ministry conferences, because they say, oh, VeggieTales, you must know everything there's to know about ministering to children. Not really. But, you know, they invite me, and I come, and I do my best. And I also speak at, like, Christian film conferences for budding Christian filmmakers, because you may not know this. There's, like, 20 Christian colleges now with full-time film programs, and we're graduating, you know, hundreds of wannabe Christian filmmakers every year now. Most of them who end up back at their home churches running the PowerPoint slides during the worship service. Because I don't know if you know this, it's not that easy to get a film made. It's just, you know, they're expensive. So when I look out at these crowds, Sunday school teachers, Christian film wannabe makers, I see people that are tired, stressed, kind of living on the edge of burnout. The Sunday school teachers, because they spend their whole lives in windowless church basements, in rooms full of third grade boys. The only time anyone ever notices them is when something goes horribly wrong. And the Christian filmmakers, of course, because the vast majority of Christian filmmakers never actually get to make a film. They spend years with a script in their hands, going door to door, trying to raise money. And it's tiring stuff. These people are tired. That's what I notice when I look out at them, is they're tired, like they're living on the edge of burnout. I noticed they look a lot like I did in about 1997, 1998. Okay, were you guys born? Okay. My daughter was born in 97, and she's about to graduate from high school, so you were born. So 1997, we just finished, I think, the 7th VeggieTales video, Madame Blueberry. Madame Blueberry, was it sad little Blueberry? And for the first time, it was actually working. It was like we were selling enough that there was more money coming in than there was going out, and I could add staff, and we could actually buy more computers, and we could like try to set up a real studio the right way, and it was very exciting. Our distributor in Nashville was so excited. It was Christmas of 1996 where it kind of took off. So, and this was early 1997. Our distributor in Nashville was so excited that when we finished the master for Madame Blueberry, they flew an executive up to take the whole company out for lunch in Chicago. We were the studio was on the north side of Chicago at the time. And they took us out to a nice restaurant. There were only like 10 of us, but they took us out to a nice restaurant and they gave me a plaque because we, I don't know, sold 100,000 videos or something like that. And everyone was excited. But then driving home that day on the Eisenhower, I lived out in Wheaton, I started to get chest pain. I noticed I was getting chest pain. And, you know, because I'm a guy, I ignored it. And I went to bed that night, and it was like getting worse, and it felt like somebody was sitting on my chest. And I was thinking, okay, this is probably something I should do something about. So at about 2 o'clock in the morning, I got up and drove myself to the emergency room. I didn't tell my wife. In hindsight, I would not recommend that. If you think you might be having a heart attack and you're going to drive to the emergency room, wake up your wife and tell her about it. So I went to the emergency room, and within about 60 seconds of walking in, I found myself flat on my back on a gurney with nitroglycerin tablets under my tongue in an alcove under a little sign that said critical. And the nurse came by and I said, why does that say critical? Because, you know, I'm funny. Why does that say critical? And she said, because you're critical. And then she walked away. And I remember thinking, oh, is this how I'm going to go? Suddenly, I regretted not waking up my wife before I left to die alone in the hospital. So they finally got a cardiologist awake. It was like 3 in the morning, and he read the EKG and said, no, I don't think he's having a heart attack. I think it's something else. Do this test and do this test and poke him with this and jab him with that and then give me the results. And they came back and said, okay, you're not having a heart attack. You have pericarditis. Pericarditis is a viral infection in the lining of your heart where the area around your heart starts to fill up with fluid. It's like instead of a sinus infection, you've got a heart infection. And if it fills up with enough fluid, it stops your heart from beating, which is bad. But if they give you a whole bunch of antibiotics and you go home and they say stay in bed for a couple weeks, you get over it and you're okay. So I went home, I recovered, they loaded me with antibiotics. And in a few weeks, I came back in for a meeting with the cardiologist and my wife came with me. I told her this time. And she came with me and, you know, asked the obvious question, so how do you get pericarditis? You know, I mean, sinus infection, you know, sore throat. Yeah, but heart infection, how do you? And the doctor looked at me and then looked at her and said, is he under much stress? The next year I got strep throat. The year after that I got shingles at age 31. An infection that usually strikes the very old or the very frail. I was working myself to death. I was under so much stress that I finally started to see a Christian counselor to talk it through. And one of the days I had a meeting with the counselor happened to be the day of the Columbine shootings. And I remember sitting in the parking lot listening to the report on the radio before I went in to the counseling session. I walked in and I said, well, have you heard the latest? Have you heard how bad it is? And he said, yeah, I've heard. But he could see how upset I was. And he said, well, what are you feeling? And I thought about it for a second, and then in an instant, my eyes filled with tears, and I said, I could have done something. I said, and he just looked at me dumbstruck, and I said, well, these boys were affected by the media they were consuming, and God has put me here to do something about the media. If I had done more, if I had worked harder, if I had started sooner, if I had put in more hours, if I had been more successful doing more faster, maybe the media wouldn't have been so toxic, and maybe this wouldn't have happened. And he stared at me for a minute, and said, wow, that's quite a burden to carry. I said, yeah, it is. I was under so much stress, I was carrying an immense burden to save the world, to make a difference, to offset the evil streaming out of Hollywood into living rooms across the country, to do as much as I could, as fast as I could, and to do it for God, to do it for all the right, best, noblest reasons. So my great-grandfather, had he still been alive, would have put me on his radio show and called me blessed for making such an impact for the kingdom. It was the first thing I thought about in the morning and the last thing I thought about at night. And it was making me miserable. I was running the race, but I was miserable. It was killing me. I was not a happy person. I found myself thinking sometimes, well, this is just what you get when you're a leader in the church. Maybe the followers are happy. And then something interesting happened. I was sitting in bed one night reading Paul's letter to the Galatians and came across his list of the fruit of the Spirit. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And for the first time, I mean, I'd heard the fruit of the Spirit before. I think I had to memorize it in Awana clubs to get a badge or something. Stressed me out. For the first time, it occurred to me what Paul meant. I was familiar with the fruit of the Spirit, but I'd always looked at it as an obligation. A duty. If you are a Christian, you have to act loving, you have to act joyful, you have to be kind and patient and self-controlled. I looked at it like homework. Oh, great, something else I have to do in addition to saving the world. But now I saw what Paul really meant. If you are filled with the Spirit, these attributes will flow out of you whether you want them to or not. For an apple tree producing apples isn't an obligation. It can't be helped. No apple tree ever accidentally produces grapes and then says, "Oh, I'm such an idiot." An apple tree produces apples for the simple reason that it is an apple tree. In the same way, the Holy Spirit produces the fruit of the Spirit in a believer because he is the Holy Spirit. If someone is filled with the Spirit, these attributes will begin falling out of them effortlessly and naturally. It can't be avoided. Not instantly, but over time. This is what happens to a believer filled with the Spirit. I turned to my wife that night and said something that startled her. "I don't think I'm a Christian." Not what she expected to hear from her creator of VeggieTales husband. I read her the fruit of the Spirit, and I said, "None of these are coming out of me. I'm not joyful. I have no peace. I'm not filled with love. I am stressed. I am cranky. I am fatigued. I am anxious. And none of those are on the list." Something is wrong with me. Something was wrong with me, but I didn't know what. So if you were here, if you're one of those six-year students and you were here the last time I spoke, or if you've read my book, Me, Myself, and Bob, A True Story About God, Dreams, and Talking Vegetables, or heard me speak somewhere else, you know what happened next. My world fell apart. The edifice I had built around myself, my company, collapsed into bankruptcy. I lost my characters. I lost my ministry. I lost everything. My means for making a difference, for saving the world, God stood back and let it all fall away. And then he showed me what I had done, how I had made the work I was doing for him more important than my relationship with him. He showed me how miserable I had become, how I was carrying this burden, dragging this rock uphill that he never intended me to carry, a burden, in fact, that only he could carry. Only one person has ever walked the face of the earth who could actually save the world, and his name wasn't Phil. So I gave up that burden. I let it go. I put down the rock I had heaved for so long, and I rested, and I read the Bible, and I prayed, and I felt God's love for me, a love so strong he was willing to let everything I was doing for him fall apart to save me from myself. That freaked me out. The great works I was doing for God weren't as important to him as I was. Wow. Then pretty soon the fruit of the Spirit started to emerge, like daffodils poking up through the snow. I felt peace, I felt joy. I felt love. My wife noticed. She liked it. I spent a few months like this after the collapse of my ministry, resting, reading the Bible, feeling God's love for me. I wrote a couple of children's books. I kept doing the voices for VeggieTales, which actually paid the bills, though I had no control over the content or the creative. Just feeling God's love for me. I wrote a couple of children's books, one of them dealing with God's love, but I didn't do much else. I sort of felt like an executive after a nervous breakdown in rehab at home, just shuffling around the house in a bathrobe and slippers, waving to the neighbors with a goofy grin on his face. Or like a star race car driver recovering after a horrific accident, just sitting at home pretending to drive with a Fisher-Price plastic steering wheel. It was nice, it was peaceful, but I thought, is this it? Am I done now? Will I just spend the rest of my life writing a few children's books, shuffling around in my slippers? It was great not to feel so burdened, so stressed, so anxious about saving the world, but was this it? And then something happened at the park. At that time, I was living in Wheaton, out in the western suburbs, and there was a park near my house, and I took a little office in downtown Wheaton just for me, and I would shuffle down in my bathrobe and slippers in the morning, and I would sit and read the Bible, and I would pray, and then there's a little deli in downtown Wheaton, and I would shuffle over to the deli, and I'd buy a sandwich, and then there was a park next to my office, and I would shuffle over as a camera guy having fun following me back and forth. And I'd shuffle over to the park with my sandwich, and it was spring, and the trees were blooming, and it was beautiful, and it was safe and suburban, and I was sitting on a park bench, and I'm eating my sandwich, and I'm feeling God's love for me, and feeling peaceful and at rest. And one day I was sitting there eating my sandwich, and two little girls ran across in front of me, going through the park. They were like 3 and 5. They were sisters, and they were climbing on the benches, and they were climbing around the fountain, and they were doing, you know, that little kid thing in the park. And then their mom came along behind them, and she's pushing the stroller. And trying to keep up and trying to keep them from falling in the fountain and trying to keep them from falling in the bushes and trying to keep them safe. And my heart went out to her because I know what she's up against. I have 2 girls, and I know what the world has in store for little girls. That in just a matter, just a couple of years, they go from Gymboree to Abercrombie and Fitch. They go from Blue's Clues to Jersey Shore. And in just a couple of years, those cute little smiles of 3 and 5-year-old girls turn into the jaded looks of middle school girls who've only learned too well that their only value on this earth is their ability to attract the opposite sex. And my heart went out for her, and I thought, how can I help her? What can I do for that mom? I thought, the world is so media saturated and so brand conscious that what if I could make a brand that produced media for her that she would know was always good for those little girls, that would help her as a parent? And then in an instant I realized, wait a minute, that's what Big Idea Productions was supposed to be. That's why I started in the first place. In an instant, all of the lawsuits and the hospitals and the lawyers and the angry conversations all was wiped away, and I could see all the way back to the beginning, to the purity of my call for a mom staring down a really messy world. And I thought, okay, God, you just spent 6 months getting me to let go of that burden. Are you asking me to pick it up again? Now I was confused. I decided to go back to Paul, to Mr. Peace, Joy, and Love. Okay, Paul. What was your life really like? Was it all puppies and daffodils? And I actually read all of Paul's letters, so I was trying to figure out what Paul's life was really like. In 2 Corinthians, he describes his life, very conveniently for my purposes. Here's what my life was like, Phil Vischer. You think it was all puppies and daffodils? Here's what my life was like, 2 Corinthians chapter 11. 5 times I received from the Jews the 40 lashes minus 1. 3 times I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. 3 times I was shipwrecked. I spent a night and a day in the open sea. I've been constantly on the move. I've been in danger from rivers, in danger from bandits, in danger from my own countrymen, in danger from Gentiles, in danger in the city, in danger in the country, in danger at sea, and in danger from false brothers. Sounds like my life. I've labored and toiled and have often gone without sleep. I have known hunger and thirst and have often gone without food. I have been cold and naked. And then he finally wraps it up and says, we are hard pressed on every side but not crushed, perplexed but not in despair, persecuted but not abandoned, struck down but not destroyed. That sounds miserable. How could Paul, why didn't this crush him? Why didn't all of this put him in the emergency room with pericarditis? Why didn't he end up half dead? How could he be filled with peace, joy, and love in the midst of all this? He wrote the letter to the Philippians. It's called the Letter of Joys, one of its nicknames, because like 15 times he says, rejoice. Again, I say rejoice. But where was Paul when he wrote the letter to the Philippians? He was in jail. Roman jail. How could Paul be filled with peace, joy, and love in the midst of all this? Now I was on a tear looking for more clues. And the first clue I got, I started writing down Paul's paradox in the margins of my Bible. How can he be joyful, peaceful when his life is heck? Letter to the Colossians, he says, we proclaim him, admonishing and teaching everyone with all wisdom so that we may present everyone perfect in Christ. To this end I labor, struggling with all my energy. And I thought, yeah, Paul, me too, and it almost killed me. Oh, wait, I misread that verse. To this end I labor, struggling with all his energy, which so powerfully works in me. It's Colossians 1:29. So, wait. How does this work? He's not being crushed by these burdens because the energy he's expending isn't his own. It's Christ's. In Galatians, he says, I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. Later in Galatians, he says, may I never boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, through which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. What Paul seems to be saying is that he's not using his own energy because he's dead. Instead, he is alive through Christ, and it is Christ's energy that is doing all this work and doing all this struggling. Is Paul loony? Does Jesus know about this? Let's take it to the big guy himself. So the gospel writer Mark tells a story about Jesus looking out at a crowd, and he says, he who does not take his cross and follow me is not worthy of me. So what does it mean to take up your cross and follow Christ? Well, as a modern American suburbanite, my first thought is, where are we going? I hope it's someplace fun. Chuck E. Cheese? If you were a first century Palestinian and you heard someone say, take up your cross, you knew exactly where you were going. You were going to die. This is possibly the strangest invitation ever made to a large group of strangers. Come on, follow me. We're going to die. Jesus continues by saying, he who has found his life will lose it, and he who has lost his life for my sake will find it. Jesus is asking every believer to give up his life. So what is Christ asking us to let go of exactly? Well, our goals, our dreams, our ambitions, our burdens. We exchange them. Instead of pursuing our goals, we pursue Christ's. Instead of following our hearts, as we've been told by every Disney movie ever, we follow Christ's heart. The biggest compliment paid to anyone in the Bible was paid to David when he was described as what? A man after God's own heart. It isn't very American, but it's absolutely biblical. And finally, we exchange our worldly burdens for Christ's burden. Is that a good trade? I mean, we're still burdened, right? How could there be a good burden? Well, Paul writes about the difference between godly sorrow and worldly sorrow in 2 Corinthians when he says, worldly sorrow brings death, but godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation and leaves no regret. So could there be burdens that come from the world and a burden that comes from Christ? Well, let's check it out. The gospel writer Matthew talks about Jesus staring out at another crowd. Crowd of just average folks, tired, stressed out, anxious, living on the edge of burnout. And he says, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. Notice that he doesn't say, come to me and you will have no burden. He says, come to me and I will put my yoke upon you. I will take your burdens and replace them with mine. What burdens you? Do you have the burden of other people's expectations? Your friends, your peers, your parents? You're here, you're supposed to be learning a lot so you can go change the world and do amazing things. You're supposed to get good grades. You got good grades in high school. Why are you struggling in college? What's the difference? It's all the same. Do you feel the weight of other people's expectations for you? Can you let those go? Can you take them to the cross, lay them down, and walk away from them? What about ego? Anyone have the burden of ego? Good? No? Okay. I do. So my company fell into bankruptcy. Not entirely my fault, but partly my fault. I'll admit it. And it was bought out of bankruptcy by two guys in New York who run a media company that buys distressed characters, basically. They own Rocky and Bullwinkle and Casper the Friendly Ghost and the Lone Ranger. And any character that has ended up down on his luck has probably ended up being owned by this company. So Bob and Larry were down on their luck, and they end up being owned by this company. So now they're going to run it. So I go out there, of course, and I'm the guy. So I go out and say, okay, I'll run it for you. I'll be the CEO of the company, but you own it, and then I'll run it, and then everything will be the same because I'm the guy. And they said, yeah, actually, we spent too much buying it to let you run it. And I thought, ouch. Well, okay, I did technically run it into bankruptcy, so maybe you have a point. Okay, and I came back to Chicago, and I thought, okay, well, what, you know, I still want to help them. So I went back out and said, okay, I'll just be the chief creative officer. You know, I'll be in charge of all the products and the characters and what they say and what they teach and what they do. I'll have final say over all of the creative, but you guys can run it. How about that? And they said, well, it's been a couple months since we talked to you last, and we just gave that position to someone else. And I got mad. And I came back to Chicago, and I thought, oh, you think you can do this without me? Well, let's just see how that goes. I will not raise a finger to help you, and when it all falls apart, don't come crying to me, because I just... And then I thought, wait a minute, I'm trying to follow God. I should pray about this. And I was in my devotions at that point. I was going through the book of Jeremiah, and I decided I was going to take a day and fast and pray, which I don't do very often because I'm fond of food. And so I was fasting and praying, and I was going through Jeremiah, and it just happened to be that day my reading was Jeremiah's letter to the exiles. If you know the backstory, the Israelites were all captured by Nebuchadnezzar and carried off to Babylon. All their precious things were carried away to this pagan land, pagan city. And I thought, okay, well, that's kind of like me because, you know, all my friends and all my vegetables and my precious things have been captured and they've been carried away and they moved them to Nashville, Tennessee, which, you know, it's not pagan, but it's weird, you know. And I thought, okay, this is like, wow, this is God. He's talking to me here. And then Jeremiah writes a letter to tell the Israelites in captivity how to posture themselves towards their captors. And I thought, oh, this is going to be good. He's going to tell them to stick it to the man and don't cooperate and don't even perform the voices anymore. And this is going to be great. And then I start reading Jeremiah 29. He says, build houses and settle down, plant gardens and eat what they produce, marry and have sons and daughters. Increase in number there, do not decrease. Also, seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I have carried you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. And I thought, oh, crap. You want me to help them. I went back to New York, and I said, okay, what do you want me to do? And they said, well, we need you to do the voices, you know, because you do the voices, and we'd love for you to give notes on scripts. You know, we may not take your notes, we may throw them in the garbage, but we just want to know what you think about the new scripts. And okay, like, for every dollar that you make on one of the old videos that I wrote, could I have, like, 2 pennies? And they went, okay. And it ended up that they made a whole bunch of dollars off of the videos that I wrote. And it turned into a whole bunch of pennies. And everything that I did in the next 4 or 5 years, the new characters I created, the time I spent just studying the Bible, writing a new book, launching a website, all of that was funded with the pennies that came from those videos. And I realized if I hadn't been willing to let go of my ego, I would have completely missed out on God's gift of provision for the next chapter of my ministry. Do you have an ego? If you don't think you do, that's the best indicator that you do. Are you willing to take it to the cross, lay it down, and let it go? Do you carry any burdens from your childhood? No? Okay, good. I do. I grew up in a ministry superstar family. I told you about my great-grandfather. He was on the radio all the time. He knew Billy Graham. He knew, you know, A.W. Tozer was a friend of my other great-grandfather. They hung out with our family. All of these, and so I would hear all these stories when I was growing up of these amazing heroes of the faith and the amazing things that they were doing. And what are you going to do, Phil? What are you going to do that's half as amazing as your great-uncle Einar, who was the first white missionary ever to enter the Balim Valley in Irian Jaya and took the gospel to cannibals? True story. What are you going to do? So I grew up trying to figure out, what on earth could I possibly do that would make me valuable? And then there was my dad. My dad was really creative, very shy, actually like me, very introverted, but very creative. I am. You hurt my feelings. But he's very creative, and he worked in advertising for a tire company. And when I was like 7 and 8 years old, I created my own fictitious tire company, and so I could make my own fictitious ads, and I would cut parts of his ads, and then I would paste them up and make my own ads for my own tire company because I just loved him. But then one day when I was 9 years old, he came down the stairs with a suitcase in his hand, and he kissed me on the forehead, and then he walked out the door. And my life split in two, the half before my dad left and the half after he left. And as hard as it was just the event, what was even more painful was the message I took from it. Because it was clear that the marriage thing was hard, that it took work. My parents, I'd noticed, hadn't been smiling at each other very much. So this is hard work. But I saw my dad look at that hard work, and then I saw him look at me, and I saw him say, it's not worth it. And as a 9-year-old kid, internally I took the message that I wasn't worth it, that I wasn't worth the hard work, that I wasn't worth hanging around for. And that message affected the next 15 years of my life, my friendships, my relationships, my marriage. Even when I'd launched Big Idea, my relationships with employees, I was convinced that anyone I really, really needed was on the verge of leaving at any point. So even several years later, at the peak of VeggieTales' success, my wife and I were staying in a hotel in Santa Monica, California. I had to speak somewhere, and I brought her along just for to get away for the weekend. We were sitting on a hotel on the beach, eating strawberries in our bathrobes, and the phone rang, and it was Time Magazine wanting to do an interview about the success of these talking religious vegetables. And even at that moment, and when everything is going better than you ever dreamed possible, there's a little voice inside me saying, now am I worth it? Now am I worth hanging around for? Am I worth the hard work? And God had to go to work on that, which he did through some friends and through my wife, to say, you know, Phil, what your dad did was a really, really hard thing. But you have been dragging that around for a long, long time. Can you let it go? And I did. And I drove up to his house, and I forgave him. And I took that burden, and I let it go. What burdens do you carry? What weighs you down? In my line of work, I'm burdened by the sense that I can't do it as well as Pixar. I can't. Is that a cheer for Pixar? Or? Against me, I'm not sure.
You sure can't do it as well as Pixar.
And I mean, the first time I'm in the middle of trying to build my little computer animation company, and I go and see Toy Story. And I just walk out of thinking, oh man, is that where the bar is now? But you know what? I don't have to compete with Pixar. Do you know why? Because I can do something that Pixar can't do. I can show kids the love of God. I'll tell you one story about that. There's a kid. In 1999, I got a letter from a kid named Thomas, and it was actually a letter from the Make-A-Wish Foundation, because Thomas was a 9-year-old boy with an inoperable brain tumor. And you know the Make-A-Wish Foundation, they try to answer the wishes of kids with terminal illnesses, and Thomas's wish was that he could be a voice in a VeggieTales video. And so we thought, okay, we're going to make this happen. So we took one of the silly songs with Larry and we rewrote it with a part for Thomas. And then we set up a date for Thomas to come in and sing with Larry the Cucumber in a silly song. And that date came, but Thomas had taken a turn for the worse and he didn't make the date. So we set up another one after that, and that date came, but Thomas didn't make that one either. And then we didn't hear anything for a couple of weeks until I got a letter. And it was a letter from Thomas's mother. And Thomas had passed away the weekend before that. And she just wanted to tell me that in the last hour that he was conscious, he had asked if he could watch the very first VeggieTales video, Where's God When I'm Scared, one last time with his family. And what broke me up was he didn't ask for the latest Pixar movie. You know, he didn't ask for a clown to come in and juggle and make balloon animals. He didn't even ask for an Xbox. He wanted to hear one more time with his family about the God who made him special and loves him very much and is bigger than anything he could be facing, even death itself. That is something I can do that Pixar can't. Mm-hmm. And it is something... It is something that you can do. My ministry doesn't start with a big budget. It doesn't start with amazing plans to change the world. My ministry starts with God's love. And not his love for the people I'm ministering with, actually his love for me. Once I rest in God's love, once I bring my burdens to the cross and lay them down and let them go and then stay at the cross, resting in God's love, not his love for the world in abstract, but his very real love for me, then my ministry starts, and the overflow of that love splashes on everyone I come in contact with. I am filled with peace, joy, and love, even in terrible circumstances, because I am filled with the power of Christ, and that is the power I am using. Let the love of God fill you until you can say, like the psalmist, my soul finds rest in God alone. My salvation comes from Him. He alone is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will never be shaken. Let His love fill you till it overflows and splashes all over those around you, because that is your ministry. I'm back at work. I've taken off the bathrobe. I got dressed first. I wasn't in the park when I took it off. It's a whole different story. Brainstorming new solutions, serving and ministering with the gifts I've been given. My new company is called Jellyfish Labs. And the reason it's called Jellyfish is I wanted something to remind me of what I've learned. And the thing about jellyfish is they can't locomote. They can't move laterally. A jellyfish can go squishy, squishy up. It can go squishy, squishy down. But it can't move side to side at all. So a jellyfish can't choose its own course. It can't say, in 5 years, I'm going to be there. No, that would be a crazy, insane jellyfish. So a jellyfish just has to stay in the current and trust that the current will carry it where it needs to be. I realized that during my big idea days when I was, you know, saving the world for Jesus and going to save the children from the evils of Hollywood single-handedly, I was conceiving of myself like a big studly salmon, you know, like, look at me, God. Not only can I swim, I can swim upstream. I can leap up waterfalls. I can dodge demonic bears. I was making plans for what I was going to do for God and then asking Him to bless them and then stand back and watch me go. And I realized as I got older, I'm not a big studly salmon. I'm much closer to a brainless, spineless bag of goo. And I get my purpose and I get my form and I get my beauty when I am suspended in the current of God's will, trusting that His will carry me exactly where He wants me to be. So on my office door, there's a jellyfish logo. So every morning I walk in and I say, yep, that's me. There are still days I start to get stressed over my plans, my schedules, my budgets, my goals. Stress will start creeping up my legs like a virus, reminding me that while I am created in the image of God, I still bear the marks of a fallen humanity. But in those moments, I go back to the words of Paul. I go back to the cross. I go back to the purity of my burden for those two little girls and their mom staring down a horribly messy world. I let go of that stress and I put my plans and schedules and budgets in God's hands. And once again, with Paul, can say, rejoice. We are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed, perplexed, but not in despair, persecuted, but not abandoned, struck down, but not destroyed. We have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. So rejoice. Again, I say, rejoice. Let me pray. You can clap a little if you want to. Just one.
Oh, nuts. He's going to pray. Stop, everyone.
Dear Lord, thank You for this day. Thank You for this institution, this place, the history, the uncountable people that have walked through here and gone on to impact the world. And thank You for the generation that's here today with goals of ministry, with goals of impact, with goals of showing Your love to the world. But Lord, let us never confuse the work we do for You with our relationships with You. Let every heart in this room be ready to lay down their burdens, whether their ego, what people have done to us in our childhood, or even our very, very good goals of reaching the world for You. Help us to be willing to nail those burdens to the cross and to let the fruit of Your Spirit fill us to overflowing so that we can find our ministry in your love and your power, so we can run the race with your endurance, not our own. In your Son's name, amen.